Another record day of cases in Victoria. Let's bring in the Shadow Health Minister and a former nurse herself, Victorian Liberal MP Georgie Crozier. Georgie, thank you for your time. Look, right from the start, on almost every comparison between Victoria and New South Wales in this current outbreak, Victoria has done worse. Today's day 57 of Delta in Victoria. The cases are 1,438. Now, that's compared with 347 in New South Wales on the same day 57 of their Delta outbreak. The Premier today blamed everyone. You know, it was all about rule-breaking Victorians for the latest surge, all about the grand final. But this is a failure of the Victorian health system and government, not Victorians, Georgie.
Peter, I saw the Premier's reaction today and I couldn't believe it. Weeks ago, our contact tracing was really struggling. It couldn't keep up. So we knew anyone that had been following what was happening, as you say, the New South Wales coast as compared to Victoria, knew that our contact tracing was failing. That's no reflection on the contact tracers. It was that the virus is out of control. And that started to be out of control in August. We are now October tomorrow. So this is a failure of government. They haven't put the systems in place. They have continually patted themselves on the back with donut days and trying to eliminate the virus, which, you know, that's questionable whether they even did that after lockdown five. But you're right. It is about a failure of government in terms of not educating the Victorians about the importance of getting vaccinated, not going into the hotspots and really concentrating on those areas where the virus was really running very fast in large numbers very early on compared to what was happening in New South Wales. And I think Daniel Andrews, again, his disgraceful behaviour today with blaming Victorians instead of his own government's failings says so much about him. And we've seen it time and time again. And that's what he does. He just blames everybody but doesn't take any responsibility for the government's own failures.
Yeah, well, over the last 6 weeks, I have been tracking the cases every single day from about day 30, compared them with where New South Wales was at the same point. We were starting out double where New South Wales was. Then we went to double and a half. Then we went to triple. Now we're four times the caseload on day 57 in Victoria compared to where day 57 was in New South Wales. We locked down at, what, 8 cases in Victoria. Locked down hard, locked down fast. I know people that are sitting in line to get a test. They wait 3.5 hours in a car in Dandenong, was the case this week, and they got to the front of the line. There was one tester only. Now, is it any wonder there's 139,000 tests the other day in Sydney? On the same day in Victoria, there were 49,000 tests. But don't just listen to me. We've got a grab here from the president of Victorian AMA, Dr. Roderick McRae, Channel 9 this morning. He is scathing.
Everybody at every stage of the Victorian health care system is using the word crisis. Well, the system has been reported, as I've mentioned to you, indeed, been under extreme strain for many, many months, and indeed it's on the back of decades of underinvestment.
So what's gone wrong, Georgie, and what can be done to fix it now?
Well, Dr. McRae's pointed out it's underinvestment over many years. And let's not forget that Daniel Andrews was the health minister and premier, and he has been for 11 of the past 15 years. So he has been the man in charge making decisions about our health system. So there's been underinvestment pre-COVID. We had a real crisis before that. You know, there was a massive shortfall in 2019. They had to inject hundreds of millions of dollars. And at the time, the government was blaming the flu. And now COVID hit, we've had elective surgery wait lists. Well, they were at record numbers before the suspension of surgery with lockdown one. So this is a system that's been in crisis and underfunded well before COVID. And of course, these pressures have only added to the woes that we're seeing today. And it's the system is so stressed. And that is a direct result, again, by government decisions. We've seen what the government has said. We're preparing you for COVID. I know that you've been talking about the 4,000 intensive care unit beds, but can I tell you, I started asking the government about this on early February of 2020. How many intensive care beds have we got? And then the government will just come out with these big headlines, but there's no substance. And I think that's partly the problem. what's gone in here. The government hasn't understood how the system works, what it's needed. So you asked me what I would have done and what should have been done and what needs to be done. It's really identifying those gaps. The government didn't do that. Where are the resources in terms of people? Have they got the expertise in place? How are we going to manage this? And bringing in people from overseas at, you know, just a couple of weeks ago is too late. And so it's going to take years to fix, but it does need to be fixed, and it's going to need a lot of work to identify the gaps and look at the system and rebuild. And I think there's a huge amount of work to be done in here because of the tragedy of what's going to happen is not just the COVID patients, but the non-COVID patients who are on these surgery wait lists that can't get in, they're waiting in pain, their lives are being put at risk. And of course, we've seen terrible response times with our ambulance system. So it's across the board. And our paramedics, our doctors, nurses, and everybody involved in the health system is exhausted because of the pressures that they've been put under.
Yeah, I'm sure you're aware, like I am, of big public hospitals clearing out patients to go into private hospitals so that the public hospitals can, in a very hurried way, be turned into COVID hospitals. The Premier last year said he'd have, you know, surge capacity at the exhibition centre and elsewhere. This is the 4,000-bed story. Then he denied it. Now we're told those secret plans are back on the table. I guess the frustration Victorians have is we are locked up tonight in Melbourne. The record 10th week of what we were told was only going to be 7 days. We're locked up because he has not prepared a system that can cope, and all the ancillary parts, testing, tracing, and all those, the sum of those elements of the health system are not ready to cope with this surge. Now, I don't know, but I fear that roadmap out is going to change for Victorians. I think it's going to be pushed out. That's almost inevitable when you look at these cases today.
Well, there's no excuse for us being not prepared now. There is no excuse, Peter. He's had 18 months to prepare for this. As you said, in the media release in April 1 last year, we are preparing for this challenge. We're investing in 4,000 intensive care unit beds. Well, they're not just beds, they're personnel. You just can't make those statements without following up, Premier. And he's given so much false hope the whole time. And I suspect you're right that the roadmap won't be what it is. And we heard mutterings of that today because these numbers are too high. And so I think that the Premier himself needs to be upfront with Victorians and saying, look, this is unmanageable. The system is at crisis. It's the AMA is saying that. But that's not what we're hearing. They're saying, no, we can cope. So that's good if we can cope, but because you've said he's gone back on his word so many times, I'm just not sure Victorians have got confidence in the management of the government and how they're managing not just this pandemic, but the entire health system.